These gentlemen have a very unique and very kind of specific kind of body of work, and they do lots of different things. But I'll let them explain exactly what their background is and how they got to the place that they're at now and what they're working on.
My name is Warren Fu. I got my start at Lucasfilm in the art department and worked in visual effects on the Star Wars prequels, and then went on to do music videos and commercials. And some of the artists I've worked with are Daft Punk, The Strokes, The Killers, Haim, and some commercials for Samsung and Reebok and Adidas.
My name is Brian Metcalf. I got my start working at Sony Pictures Entertainment, and then from there I was doing visual effects, and then went off to be doing creative directing. And from there I went on to doing directing for commercials, music videos, and then to independent films.
My name is Ian Trutner, and I started off at Disney in feature animation years ago, and then went on my own, did a bunch of short films, and then got my first feature film, and produced several films that have screened festivals, Cannes, South by Southwest. And then my most recent film, Talios, is being released next week at the Sci-Fi London Film Festival and is distributed. And so far, we've just started, but it has distribution in China, Korea, Japan, and the UK.
Hi, my name is Phil Tan. I got my start in London at the Actors Centre and Royal Youth Theatre. And after a few years of training, I landed a TV series, 56 episode, on Granada Television as an actor. And then from that, I went into doing stunts. I started to, because I was a national champion gymnast and a national champion martial artist, I started to go into the stunt world. And I started working for Steven Spielberg, Empire of the Sun, Indiana Jones, and then I went to do the original Batman. And then I came over here to do Tango and Cash. And then I started working for Sony, John Peters, you know, he became the president of the studio. And anyway, after 100 to 200 movies and TV show, I decided to start joining the DGA. And now I have a development deal with a very big producer, Tucker Tooley Production, to do a $10 million movie.
And my name is Kevin Berlandi. I co-chair the Asian American Committee at the Directors Guild. I started off as an assistant director working on feature films, a lot of franchise films like Transformers and Born Legacy and things of those nature, and then transitioned into directing. I direct commercials, and I have a short film that's actually going to be secretly playing here on closing night. that's my quick background. So one of the first things, and just so everyone is aware, my idea and concept for this panel is to be sort of a casual conversation amongst directors talking about what they do and the tools that they use, specifically in regards to the technology. And so the first thing that I'd like to pose to everybody is, what are your go-to pieces of technology, whether it's a piece of hardware or a software or a technique that you go to all the time, that's sort of, you know, the secret weapon that you tend to pull out the most often?
Since I came from an art background, a lot of pre-vis stuff and preparing happens with a pen and sometimes on paper, but a lot of times with the Wacom tablet, Cintiq. So I have a big screen and I actually do all my editing on there, so that's sort of my go-to hardware. But then I use a combination of different things to tell the story. A lot of times I'll sketch things out. I don't know 3D stuff personally. I know how to direct people using it, but most of my drawings are 2D, and then I'll do concept art. A lot of times that helps sell things to the clients that you're working with. And a lot of times it helps to create an animatic for the music videos that are a little more complicated, just so that people can all be on the same page, and I'll take the drawings and bring them into Premiere. I used to use Final Cut, and now that's kind of gone obsolete in terms of what filmmakers use. So I use Premiere now and create a lot of previs and automatic that way.
And then with those tools, are you, in terms of workflow, do you find that those become the wireframes for what the, if it is visual effects driven, are they using, you know, those source files to help create what eventually becomes that sequence?
Yeah. A lot of times I'll just create like a still image of concept art for the visual effects guys to kind of base it off of. And I actually like to be a lot of the visual effects post work that happens. Recently we did one for Snoop Dogg and Pharrell. It was a very visual effects heavy video, and I like to actually be there day to day in the studio, so I could just like quickly do a sketch or a piece of artwork and send it off to them.
And then is your image capturing, are you using a Red camera or an Alexa or a Phantom, or is there any?
Yeah, I it was really fun. I got to use a Phantom for this last a video for Electric Light Orchestra, where we had the doggy cam systems. Have you ever heard of those guys? They have all these kind of crazy rigs. So they have a real, I shot a test on my iPhone, actually, where we were on a subway, and I just held the slow motion camera up to the people passing by, and it had a really cool effect when you're going really fast, but people are all moving in slow motion, so it seemed like a weird kind of diorama or sculpture in a way. So I researched the fastest sliding rig I could find, and it was doggy cam. They said it could, you know, go a certain speed. And so I got to shoot with the Phantom and combine that with that, and it had a really kind of surreal moving painting kind of feel.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah. So that's like, as far as visual effects goes, it's probably like my favorite thing I've done.
And then you use Premiere, and so do you find that the Adobe workflow, it works best for you in terms of the way you visualize and the different artists that you work with? Because I know...
Yeah, because I'm very Photoshop-based. Like, I paint everything in Photoshop, and so the quick keys and everything are very kind of in that world already. So it's actually better that I stopped using Final Cut, because Premiere and now After Effects, where I do some like post shots. I don't know how to do full-on 3D, crazy 3D shots, but I could do a lot of matte paintings, and if there's simple shots that I could do on my own, then it's nice to be able to just go into double-click on something in Premiere, and then it opens in After Effects, and I could do a shot, and then it's already back into the edit.
So you're pretty hands-on then. You're also one of your own artists in terms of...
Yeah, I'm trying to let go of that. I get a little crazy by the end, like pulling all-nighters and stuff, but I'm also kind of a control freak, so...
Gotcha.
But I do like to edit myself, too, and nudge frames, I guess.
And then for the visual effects portion, are you using After Effects?
Yeah.
And then all those plug in pretty seamlessly in terms of workflow, right? Like if you generate something in Photoshop, you can import that pretty easily into...
Yeah. I'll create stuff in sometimes even Illustrator if it's like a designy kind of angular hard surface kind of thing, or hard angle kind of thing. But yeah, that all kind of flows into Photoshop, Illustrator, and then you can import things into After Effects pretty easily. Like I'll do grab some images, create a matte painting in Photoshop, and then drop it into After Effects, and then that goes into Premiere.
And then do you have these assets on set with you on the day when you're shooting to be able to help someone visualize?
Yeah. I like to, as much as I can, usually these music videos, you like have a week to prep, or sometimes 2 weeks if you're lucky. But I'll try to do as much to get the artist excited. You know, like I think I showed Snoop a painting of him flying in a car, and he's like, oh shit, that's dope. I'm down.
Sounds like Snoop.
Yeah. But yeah, that's, I think it's just kind of a nice tool to have in your back pocket to, because a picture explains things a lot better than
words
do. So.
Yes, it does. Yeah. And then, Brian, is this something that's similar to, because I know you have a pretty strong visual effects background as well, correct?
I also use Premiere now after Final Cut died or so forth, but I'm also using, along with the Adobe suite, which is a similar workflow within Photoshop and After Effects and Premiere, But I'll jump into Maya, which is a 3D program. I'll jump into RealFlow for doing particles based with fluids for blood and so forth. And I'll jump into Particle Illusion when I'm really lazy and don't want to do the particles in Maya or anything like that. And nowadays, I'm actually using certain plugins for doing the 3D text effects. If I'm doing 3D logo designs or anything like that, I'm not doing it so much in Maya anymore. I'm just doing it inside of After Effects nowadays. So.
Gotcha. And do you feel that, you know, being so heavily involved in the actual visual effects, being the artist as well, is that something that helps you connect to the material?
Absolutely. I mean, especially if you're doing a specific shot for something, you know if it's going to work or not work by looking at it in playback. You'll be able to tell, well, this is obviously going to be a problem for me later on. A lot of times also, I know that if I hire some other people that are working alongside with me on some of these films or whatever, I know they'll be kicking me if I give them a bad shot. They can actually kick me directly, so. I try to make sure that green screens are lit properly and, you know, that just the coverage looks right and everything there, not too shaky. And if we have stabilization, we have proper tracking tools and equipment for that as well.
So you find that it allows you, like, on set during the on the day that you can focus more on telling the story with the performer, and it is it more liberating, or do you feel like sometimes it really can be that obstacle the whole time?
It can be a give and take of both. I mean, literally, you try to plan out everything that you're going to do for the day in advance, but sometimes problems happen or schedules change around with talent or whatever the situation is. I mean, ideally, when I'm directing, I like to try to focus on directing, but a lot of times, because I'll end up shooting a lot of the stuff myself, I like to, or I'll need to feel that I'll look in there and make sure that the shots look right and so forth for visual effects.
And then, you know, I think we've sort of all had some kind of experience like that where the talent just, regardless of the direction you give, has this way they're going to do it, and it completely conflicts with what you had sort of pre-vised or mapped. At that point, like, is it scrap all of it, go back to the drawing board in terms of the visual effects that you've had in your mind in the sequence, or is it working through to try to get your talent on script, so to speak?
It depends on which talent you're talking to. I mean, there are cases where there is some talent where you try to explain it to them. They're like, oh, okay, and then there are certain other ones who are more old school who are like, no, I'm going to do it this way. So you have to try to work with them. They're charging, you know, anywhere from 10 to 100,000 a day or whatever to be there. So, and you only have a certain amount of time with them. So you just try and get the footage that you can and realize you're going to have to fix it over in post.
Great. And then, Ian, I know that you were a partner at a visual effects company, right? Prior.
I'm a partner at a production company.
Okay. Yes. My apologies.
And we did. Kind of old school, new school, which is projection.
So tell me a little bit about that, because I know that projection, you know, is this really old school way, sort of like a poor man's process, that has a huge resurgence now with LEDs and with the quality of projection, the size of the screens, the short throws. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, I think when people think projection, they think of those old Hitchcock movies where you see the guy driving in the background,
just
kind of shaking,
yeah.
And the guy's pretending to drive the car. And it's really progressed a lot, like technology has in general. And sometimes the best tools that we use are the old tools that have been updated for modern purposes. And I think what we did is a science fiction film, and I didn't have a huge post-production budget to throw at ILM and have them fix some sloppy green screen work. So what we did instead is inside of our spaceship environments, we had screens that were set up and then projectors behind them that would project outer space or whatever you want on them. You can flip the projector, and sometimes the sets, if you have a set that's covered with windows, depending on what's on the projector, it looks like a completely different environment. There's a couple different types of material you can use. You can use transparent material, which looks like you're looking, you know, you can look through it. You can project on it, and so it holds an image that looks like a holographic image on it. Or there's opaque images, which look like walls. And so in our set, it can either be a wall, a gray wall, or a white wall, depending on which type of material you use. And then when you project behind it, it holds a very, very vivid, sharp image, surprisingly sharp. And the projectors that we're using are fisheye lenses, so they didn't have to have that much throw behind it, maybe about to project on something maybe that's about that size up to that first marker on the rest of the wall, it needed to be about 8 feet away to fill that whole space with a very sharp image. So in my case, it really ended up, it took a little bit more time on production, but it saves us a lot on post-production. And what was valuable on as far as the production experience is that the actors, when they walked in, were walking onto a fully realized set. They're not walking and looking at a ping pong ball hanging from the ceiling and not knowing which direction anything is. So they'd walk in and they'd have fully immersive environment, and through Flash, we were able to program in simple commands. So if they were able to, they went to the panel. This is kind of what Star Trek The Next Generation did too, where everything was kind of looked like a touch screen, became the model, I think, with which Steve Jobs was inspired by to create the iPad. But that's essentially what it was. But that's, he did that as he had a projector behind that. We use the same type of technology, except advanced on that is projector or is commands. So in some cases, we actually used flat screen tablets, and you'd be able to touch a button, and then something would change on the screen up there. So like I said, it added a little bit more time to the production cycle, but in the long run, it was so invaluable, because we walk into post-production, and you have your image. You're not looking at a green screen and then trying to figure out, okay, that's supposed to look like this. We need to put all these things in there and keying it out and having highlights in the hairs and things like that. So. I wouldn't say that's an arsenal thing for me, but it's definitely a new thing that I tried in this in my last film, and it worked very well.
And Phil, you come from a much more real world, like real time and space kind of, you know, the background in your craft, choreographing fights, working with stunt guys, you're sort of like the last bastion of reality in the things that we do. Tell me a little bit about some of the technology that you guys use to help make sure that sequence works and that, you know, that's a compelling, fun fight sequence.
Yeah. Before I say that, I was on his set, and I was an actor on his set, and it looked amazing, by the way. And I've done a lot of movies, so...
It's still only as good as the actor, though. We did some visual effects on him with blood, but if he didn't sell it, it still is worthless.
It was really good. The set was just... And the effects, I was like, whoa, I'm in another world here, you know? Because normally it's like blue, and you don't know what that is. But he actually created the set, so really impressed me. So I've done a lot of movies, so it's hard to impress. You try to get it better. You try to go better... You know, in technology or in telling a story, you know, so we're good job, by the way. We use this, a lot of time we use the Prevuses. Years ago, 89, I started using it because the act, you know, it was on Tango and Cash, and the actor was very, very busy, so they were shooting or they were doing stuff, and we couldn't get them on set to time aside for rehearsal. They got to fight like 25 people, you know, Sylvester Stallone and Kurt Russell. So I would do the Prevuses, and I would choreograph like five routines, you know. And in those days, I mean, we didn't have the technology like we have now, you know what I mean? Our cameras are really, you know, big and expensive, and time to cut and edit, it's a nightmare. It's not like what we have now, you know. So I would, you know, choreograph five routines and cut it all together, and this is the Sylvester Stallone stunt double and the Kurt Russell stunt double, and we'll fight 25 people, choreograph it, and then I'll bring it to Sly Stallone and let him have a look at it. And he go, oh, I like the third one. That's the one we'll do, you know? But at least the directors, this is like in 89, so the directors will go, wow, that's great. Now we know this is the prison scene, we're gonna do this fight like this, and this is the routine that Stallone picked and Kurt Russell picked. And so, you know, we're going to now, you know, try to get them to do the rehearsal as much as possible so that it's not a surprise to the directors. Now, coming back to, you know, 20-some years later, we're still doing the same thing, except the camera, you know, we use like 5D or something, you know, we can edit, cut, and show to our directors, and he can... We piece it together for him. We put some music, sound, you know, even little effects sometimes, you know, the knife coming, you know, flying in the air and hit him here, you know, you see a knife coming, and it, you know, take a reaction, and we even put some blood. Sometimes we put, you know, firing of guns, we just go like this and like that, and then boom, it blows up, you know. So they can see what's going on, and lo and behold, you know, the directors, they love it so much now that some of my friends that are up and coming, 25-year-old fight choreographer, second year director, they're getting younger and younger. It's amazing. It's awesome. And they would show to the directors, and the director goes, this is exactly what we're going to do, like that. And this is like, I'm talking big movie, like, you know, now we've got the Wolverine, then we have X-Men and all the people. Some of my associate from the 87-11 team of guys that did the 300, the Matrix, and on and on, now the Bourne Identity, and John Wick, you know, one of my very good collaborator, Chad Stahelski, is now directing John Wick and 1 and 2, you know. So, you know, we've been together for like many, many years, and his assistant, David Leitch, he's also doing an $18 million movie. So it just shows you the progression of from where, you know, and it's all coming from previouses. We do previouses, we execute on set exactly, you know, and sometimes, of course, you have to change things to tell the story, you know, because that wasn't on set at the time. There's a table or this amazing object that we're going to use. We're going to use this. So we come away from the previouses, talk to the director, of course, and he approves everything. The producers, how much it's going to cost to make this happen, and we enhance it with either wire work, you know, try to incorporate into our storytelling. So it works very, very well, because you actually it's not a surprise to the directors what we're going to do, and the director goes, this is the way I'm going. He's already given us his vision, and we enhance his vision with the previouses. So
it's, you know, It's sounding like all of these tools that everyone's using is to help visualize and actualize what your vision in your brain is. First of all, thank you guys for sharing those things. My next sort of topic is, what are the new tools that you're seeing that are exciting you? What's something out there that you may or may not have used, or have used only briefly, and haven't feel like you've actualized what it's, you know, like what its full potential is? But I'm just curious as to, you know, as you're moving forward and you're seeing new things, because it seems like, you know, every month somebody's announcing, whether it's a new camera or, you know, lenses that are designed to work with the larger sensors, or, you know, on any level, you know, whether it's, you know, the camera that registers all the metadata from the lenses and things of that nature, to whether it's 3D or visual reality or augmented reality. I mean, there's a lot of sort of hot phrases right now, and I'm just curious, for each person individually, what's the thing that's really exciting you, and or what's the thing that's like freaking you out the most? Because for me, you know, there's this, like, I'm not sure how this whole visual VR thing is, you know, like, yeah, what's gonna lead to.
Yeah, there's been a lot of, I haven't actually done anything in VR yet, there's been a lot of talk about stuff, and I've been approached to doing some projects in VR. And I think the biggest challenge for me is I come from, the way my mind works is I like the storytelling aspect of taking somebody on a journey. Like, the audience is sort of passive, and you're the director's showing you exactly what you want them to see. And in VR kind of eliminates that, in that there's more of this kind of free will thing where you're looking wherever you want instead of where the director wants you to look. So I'm really curious to see how storytelling is going to work in that world, and how editing is going to work too, because VR is supposed to simulate the actual sensation of life. You don't jump cut to, you know, across the room. So I'm kind of curious to see how people, it's going to be a new language, basically,
right,
that
new
whatever
visual
VR
language.
Yeah. So, I haven't explored it that much yet, so I'm curious to see. I have some demos that people are going to show me coming up, so I'm excited, but cautious at the same time, I guess you'd say.
What's the component of it that you think is the most exciting part of it?
I guess just being, just having a fully immersive experience, just having, you know, the sound design and the sort of kind of stereo sound in your ear and just kind of having a more fully visceral experience. I guess that's the exciting thing. I mean, the first time I saw Avatar, and you're going over, I think, what were those dragons? I forgot what they were called. But yeah, there's a scene where you're walking over the on a branch and looking down, and there's a sense of, in 3D, there's a sense of vertigo, I guess, like when you're looking down, and that was pretty exciting. So I would imagine that VR would be that times 100 once it gets to a certain point.
And Brian?
Aside, I also agree about the whole VR thing. I think that's really exciting, and imagining after they came out with the first Avatar, what's next. In terms of other technology, one thing that got me really excited were the new Sony A7s, where you can film completely in the dark without any light at all, I think. That, in a way, is a sort of a game changer for doing low budget, being able to film around at night without any lighting equipment and having to bring, you know, huge lights and everything for that. So, and I think the technology is just getting better and better in terms of these small cameras that are able to do 4K now and 6K and everything like that.
Now, are you concerned a little bit with, you know, because the A7S is a wonderful platform, and I think that all these new ridiculously high ISO cameras are going to open things up. But is there a concern to losing some of the craft of, you know, being able to paint with light and being able to create moods and with these cameras that are going to almost need to be used in the natural environment, because once you start pumping light into them, you lose all kind of information off of that.
Well, I mean, you have the option to always turn down the ISO in the cameras, but the one thing that I think these cameras are able to do is a lot of times, you know, you're trying to simulate nighttime with the old film cameras and everything. My first film, we shot 35mm, and it was really frustrating because a lot of scenes were dark. And I think that with these types of cameras, you don't have to simulate it. You're actually getting the real thing. You're getting the real lighting from the streets and everything else. And everything from there. And then if you want to add in lights to do certain things, you have the freedom to do so. I mean, it's not meant for just being sloppy, but it's to be used when you absolutely need to, right? And you don't have the budget for anything big.
Yeah, I'm interested to see how its application is, because I think now everyone's trying to increase their frame rates, mm-hmm. just for higher resolution. I know that, you know, Ang Lee right now is shooting his whole film at 120 frames. And, you know, 3D, and I've heard it is insane, like, in terms of not just the visual aesthetic, but the emotional connection that you wind up getting with the characters. I think he just released 10 minutes of it at NAB, and everyone walked out of there like, what just happened to me?
So the playback is...
So, yeah, so they match the frame rate back, so uh-huh. it's not like the whole movie's in slow motion, uh-huh. but he's capturing at 120 and in 3D so that... Okay. You know, it's just more information throughout, yeah. and apparently it's just really intimate.
Wow.
Because it's just, because at 24 years old, there's a lot of motion blur within each yeah. frame, and I think it just eliminates all of it, and so you have control over the movement within it, and so I was just curious. Ian, for you, like, what's on the horizon? What's the thing that's, you know, charging you away right now?
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head when you said the emotional connection, and I think to me that's the most important factor when you're considering any technology. I love 3D, although I have to say that in the last, you know, 5 to 10 years, the only films that I feel really, really fully realized the potential of it and it justified using it 3D were Avatar and Gravity, because you felt like you were mm-hmm. really immersed in there. And then there's a lot of times where it just seems to be a sales gimmick to try to, you know, charge you a little bit more to put on some plastic glasses and, you know, and get a little bit more hype behind it. And the virtual reality is amazing. The DGA actually had sponsored that event, some of these things where you're put in a chair and you're going through a mental hospital. For one thing, the logistics of that are extremely complex, because you have to have a camera that shoots 360, and so where do you put your PA? You know, where's Video Village go? So you really have to create an immersive set. And also, I think its application is much more oriented toward gaming, because you have to put this apparatus on your head that covers your senses. And part of cinema is the social component of it, that, you know, you can hold the hand of the person that you're sitting next to, or you can at least see their popcorn. But if you're wearing this thing, you can't, you know, you're trying to reach in blindly in the dark, and you can't make out with somebody sitting next to you with this thing on there either. So, but I feel there are definitely components. I'm you know, anything Ang Lee does, obviously, if he does it, then he's going to do it right. And like what he did with Life of Pi, I stand yes. corrected. Life of Pi was another one that really had that good. Fully immersive component. But I still feel at the end of the day, you choose the technology that supports the narrative that you're trying to portray. And then as a filmmaker, I think the most important secret weapon, technologically or not, is psychology. You know, it's really understanding not the psychology of the story that you're trying to tell, but also the psychology of the people that you're working with, and getting them to, especially on a shoestring budget, follow a collective vision. And no matter when I was using the projection technology, because there's a disconnect sometimes when I was using it for the first time. Whenever you're using it, something for the first time, it's trying to understand what they already understand and communicate to them in that language. The guy that was doing my projection stuff had done it on numerous feature films, and he was this eccentric guy, probably kind of borderline genius, but along with genius sometimes comes that weird eccentricity. And communicating with him was really, really hard. He's from Montreal, so French was his first language, so that was already a disconnect. But eventually, once we found that synergy and that flow, it was an incredible experience. But I have to say, for the first week or two, it was pretty bumpy. So if you can understand how to harness each one of those components and how to harness both the human capital and the technology capital, that's the key to really doing well as a filmmaker.
So do you feel like with you know, like you said, VR and 3D, that we're closing the gap at the Uncanny Valley, or is it just different? And you know, do you, because you talked about the psychology of it, and I think that that's really important as a storyteller, because you know, there's this suspension of disbelief that we all have to accomplish by creating our world.
Yeah, I don't think the technology ever makes anything easier, for one thing, and a lot of times people just say fix it in post, and I think that's, you know, to me, is a four-letter word on a film set, because it ultimately end up creating more problems than you hope you're going to solve later. But also, there's some tests that I saw, and I'm not going to mention exactly what it was. Virtual reality not done that well, and it's because they were so immersed in the technology aspect of it, like, ooh, cool, this is something we can create, that the acting was quite hammy. And unfortunately, when you're shooting with these 360 cameras, you don't have the opportunity to cut during the middle of a take. So you're in there, and there's a fight scene, you know, that would make you cringe, I'm sure. Made me cringe, so I'm sure you'd probably fall over laughing. But it was, you know, a couple people that were, you know, the acting was kind of cheesy. In terms of the camera movement and everything that was going on, it's like, okay, this is technically really good, but then what was lacking was the very basic fundamental storytelling, which is good acting, good narrative, and good movement. And I think that's where we always have to kind of find that balance. And there are some people like Ang Lee who's able to figure that out, but it's because he's a master storyteller to begin with and is able to infuse the technology into it. But too often people jump to the technology first before learning the fundamental of basic narrative.
Yeah, that's a good point you brought up with the emotion being the most important thing to capture with the audience. It's because there's always going to be advances in technology, and there's always going to be people that are trying to make a quick buck out of the latest thing. But you know, the thing, if you look back throughout your whole life, your favorite things are always the things that hit you emotionally, whether it be you know, a sentimental story, or you know, the emotion of a you know, a fight scene or whatever. But all that stuff, you know, the storytelling thing is always what comes first.
I agree. Yeah, storytelling is definitely
the most important. You know, it's becoming now where the rigs to support all this new technology make it virtually impossible to reach your talent. Like, I mean, you've got to like either get up on an eighth step to be able to see the person, because you've got this array of cameras now that's in front of them. Phil, what is it, you know, for you right now? I know that, you know, fight choreography in terms of in its essence is always going to be about compelling action and overcoming those physical obstacles. But what is it that's exciting you right now, you know, as all of these action movies are coming out and, you know, everyone's trying to push the limits to action sequences? Is it technology for you that's exciting to make it grow, or is it going back to the basics for you?
I think it's going back to the basic. I think like you're saying, you know, Ian, that you know, it's all about the storytelling. You know, technology is great. It's going to come and go. It's going to be a new thing. You know, like a week ago it was Hardcore Henry. You know, and it's like the camera's like over here. You know, and we you know, talked to one of my friends who worked on that for the whole show, because we had the director was doing this Taco Bell web thing, and he says, "Look, I want to do a fight sequence like Hardcore Henry. You know anything about that? Can you get the camera?" I said, "I know just the right guy, my buddy who did it." You know. So I went to get the rig, you know, and we rigged one of my son on the show to do the Hardcore Henry fight, you know. So it was like a GoPro, like here, you know, and he looked down and he'll get hit, and he look up, he gets hit, you know, and then there's two beautiful babes beating the crap out of him. So, you know, for the whole minute, this went on, you know, and so because that's what they wanted to do, and it worked really, really well. But it's like we choreographed it as a team to enhance the technology and not make people want to throw up, you know, because I went to see the actual movie, and for 2 days after that, I felt sick, you know, and I understand why. It's really good, but it's just they didn't put it on the camera where, you know, it wasn't shaky. So he's running, he'll be like this, you know, and you're like, you're like this, you know, all the way home, and I'm pretty, you know, I can stand a lot of stuff, you know, and I can understand now why there's only like few people in the room. It's a good movie, but after that, I was queasy for like a day or two, you know what I mean? So you don't want technology to, but I think that now the, you know, there's the new GoPro coming out, and they got other cameras now that have anamorphic lenses, so you can change on it, and you need to have it on, use it so that it doesn't make people sick, you know, maybe, you know, a stabilizer, you know, on it. So I think that for those out there, you know, look, don't worry about technology. They're going to come and go. Worry about storytelling. Spielberg always says this to me. Do what you know. Tell the story. Why am I having this shot? You know, I learned a lot from it, you know, because I'm, you know, with him for a long, long period of time, like 6 months, and then 6 months on another movie. And why did you do this shot? Because this tells me, you know, where I am, this location, you know. And then I'm doing it so to tell the audience, here I am. We've arrived at this place. You know, why you did this tracking shot? Because it's telling a story. Don't do the shots just because it looks good, right? Or use the technology because it, you know, it looks good. But you're taking the audience out of the story for 10 seconds. That's 10 seconds that's missing out of their life. You should engage, and that drives the story. So don't just, you know, always look at the technology, use the technology. Like, for instance, you know, if there's a drone that has a red camera, you know, and I was like, okay, I love a red camera on a drone. And it's going to come out soon, by the way. They're already developing it. So, you know, it can fly for like 45 minutes or an hour and a half, you know. So it's going to come down like this, you know, and then let's go around. And this guy who's fighting like, you know, 15 guys. So we go around him, take a hit. Go all the way around to about here, and then boom, we go straight up to 100 feet. That'll be cool. I've never seen that before, you know, right? You know, so 100 feet coming down, establishing the actor, people come in, take him out, he takes out 15 guys, and then from right on his face, we go up. So I look at that and go, okay, now is there a machine that, a drone or a camera I can mount onto? Right now, maybe a small drone and a small camera. And we've already tried all this stuff, you know? So we try to push that envelope where we have, you know, the technology that will tell the story that we want to tell that haven't been seen. And that's being smart, you know? But always remember, tell the story, more important than anything else.
It's interesting, too, because, like, I after Birdman came out, you know, all the filmmaker people were like, oh, it's all one shot, and how did you do that? And it was interesting because, like, one filmmaker friend said, you know, it was too distracting. I was just paying attention to where all the cuts were. Then I talked to another friend. I talked to another friend who's not a filmmaker, and I said, yeah, it was all one shot, because this was before I saw it, and he's like, what do you mean? He didn't even notice that it was a one shot movie, which is.
Because the story was so.
He was captivated by the story.
Very interesting. And so that brings up my next question is what are the things that, or the material, whether it's your own or something else, that's really working, that uses a technology that works? I know that you had, made reference to like Gravity and now Birdman, but what are the things that are using technology that in a way that you feel like is actually elevating story? And if you've used it in your own work, I think that would be helpful just to see how that workflow and how it came to genesis or to reality. Because I know that oftentimes we talk about what it can do and how it can do that, but it's a matter of actually the application of it. And I'm just curious for you guys, what's that thing that has you know grabbed you, whether it's your own piece or whether it's someone else's, and why? And feel free, anybody, to jump in. This is sort of an unplanned question.
Well, you know, for me, I like the bear, the Revenant. You know, my buddy, Leo DiCaprio, so he's filling me in on all the stuff they were doing, and I thought I was amazing before they even knew that he was actually a human being with a suit, you know. But that's exciting to see that we can use technology the correct way. Everybody's like, oh my God, it's a bear that killed him, you know. It's amazing. It really is amazing, you know. I even thought that. I was like, how did they get that bear to do that, you know?
Yeah.
you know what I mean? And then, of course, then we... You know, we use the bear and the human being with the wire, so, you know, he get picked up by the bear's mouth and thrown across, and it's all in one shot, and it looks so real that it captivates the audience. Now, that's great storytelling, in my opinion, you know, using technology the correct way. You know, I just went to see Jungle Book, and it was, again, you know, amazing. It's a great movie, I loved it, and, you know, my other buddy worked on that. He doubled the lead on that, so he's, you know, sending me stuff to take a look at how they did it, and it's all green screen and blue screen, sorry, you know, and everything, there's no tree anywhere, it's just like a table, it jumps over a tree, so they jump over tables, green, a blue screen, but it's so well done that you don't know, you know, that it's, that he's jumping over, instead of a branch, where there's a blue table, you know, but it's just so smart, the technology, now that's a great storytelling using technology.
Phil, do you think then that the technology, because it's become so advanced, is now transparent, and that, you know, as audience members, we realize that anything can be achieved, so we're not really, it's sort of whatever. You can use 3D, or you can use IMAX, or you can, you know, whatever the device is, it doesn't really matter anymore, because we all know, well, yeah, you know, you can make it look like a spaceship is there. We know that there aren't really spaceships like that, but do you think that means we've sort of gone past technology?
No, I think, again, you know, you've got to, it's, technology will come and go, and they get better and better. Sometimes they're not very good, you know. If we don't use it correctly, then it looks silly, you know what I mean? We're like, oh my God, come on. You look at the CG, how many times you walked out of a movie, you go, that CG, it was horrible, because it didn't work, you know, because they used it wrong, you know. And so it's not because it's horrible, it's just they used it wrong. And I think that it's got to be used correctly. Being a, you know, as directors, you know, we got to, again, enhance and telling the story instead of the, you know, the story isn't the technology. The story is the story. So use the technology to enhance it and make it better instead of the other way around. Oh, we're going to, because we've got CG, we're going to put it in, you know, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. It doesn't work that way, you know. Like, you know, there's nothing that haven't been done. There's a lot of stuff that's been done. It's just the technology got better. I worked with Jim Henson, you know. I know him personally on a great Muppet Caper, you know, and they would use the puppet and Muppet and doing stuff. And now they're using the same technique, a Muppet, but on the Jungle Book, but it's like a little green thing, you know, with eyes on it, you know. And so that will be the person that we're looking at the eyes, and then it became a wolf that talks, okay? So I'm just saying this to you, that's a good enhancement of technology, because they didn't make you feel you were still in the story, and there was a lot of emotion involved with the son and the mother relationship and all that. It's beautifully done, you know, and there is nothing that's never been done. I mean, it's like, you know, Alejandro did this one-shot thing, you know, 10 minutes, you know, and if you really look at it, who did that? You know, 15 minutes of shot nonstop. It was John Woo, Hard Boiled, except he did it with guns. He just replaced gun with dialogue. So you've got to think out, you've got to think, how do we get that better? John Woo did the gun thing, 15 minutes, you know, and he hit guns everywhere. So the cut, there was no cuts, you know. Amazing, brilliant. In those days, he's a genius. So, you know, somebody looked at that and go, okay. I don't know if he took it from there, but that's what I would have done. I was like, okay, make it yours. And Steven said this to me. Steven said, always, look, don't copy things, you know, frame for frame, because you're a hacker, all right? You know, I took this and I'm going to make it mine, but I stole it from this guy, you know. Make it yours. Make this scene and this movement of film and camera angle yours to your story. And then if you do that, you're a genius. But if you just copy frame for frame and then, you know, and put it in your movie, you're a hacker. So don't be a hacker, he said to me. And I'll never forget that. So.
Now, Brian, you've mentioned budgets and, you know, use of technology to help with that. How is it that, you know, for me personally, I tend to use technology, not necessarily on screen, but in a either time saving or workflow, because I know, you know, all the cameras now can output almost any codec. So, you know, in terms of post, you can really streamline your post process. I also, as sort of my own go-to tool, is I shoot a lot in 6K so that I can extract coverage. If I know I'm not gonna have that extra 3 hours to shoot, you know, six extra setups or something like that. Tell me a little bit about, for you, how you've used technology for cost savings.
Well, that's exactly one of the examples right there. What you just mentioned is if you're going to shoot 6K and then you can zoom in closely for some of the coverage that you have, that's one example. I mean, obviously you can quickly edit things together on a desktop, you know, on laptop nowadays, and do color correction really quickly. I mean, everything from, you know, using After Effects all the way over to using any of the other softwares and stuff. It's just really quick and refined and everything for there. And of course, using, you know, you don't need a big camera now. Anyone can shoot 2K and 4K with little digital cameras and everything. So. I think it's just opened up and allowed people a lot more to just get out there and shoot things. And that's why there's so many content creators on YouTube nowadays, to just get out there and shoot and do this different technologies and stuff for there. So I think that's just one of the great ways. And also being able to shoot on green screen. If you don't have much of a budget and you want to shoot a scene that's out in the jungle or something like that really quickly to put the person on the green screen, and then you just create the background that you need to create, and then you have that shot that you need. So,
awesome. And I, just to sort of, I think at this point, we're getting close to where we need to start opening the floor for questions. What's up next for everybody in terms of either it's your next project or something that's coming out, or the thing that you're going to be diving into soon?
I'm doing a video for an artist where I can't really say the because it's one of those kind of surprise things where they want to just release the video as a, it's becoming more of the trend now, I think, with social media and stuff, I think.
Are you able to tell us who the artist is?
No.
Okay.
But, yeah, I think also I have plans of, like, trying to do a short film, I think, this year, too, as well. But there's some VR things that, I've been sort of talking to people about, but I haven't fully jumped into it because I still need to see how it really works and everything still.
Brian?
I'm in post-production on a feature film and a television pilot, but in addition, I'm creating a sort of content creation channel sort of for YouTube and everything like that, where I'm going to be putting on short films. We've already shot a few films, short films, and we're working with different actors to come in and shoot little things here and there, 2-minute shorts and stuff.
Excellent. Ian?
Well, this blends in with your previous question about what new technology is interesting. I'm interested in technology that that's economic empowerment. And I think everybody hopefully is in the position where they're worrying about whether they want to shoot 120 frame, you know, $100 million film. You're going to choose the Alexa camera or what other camera. But I'd say that for the most part, most conversations I have with filmmakers, it's how do I get my movie made? And then after how do I get my movie made is how do I finish my movie? And then after how do I finish my movie is how do I get somebody to see it? And then after how do I get somebody to see it is how do I make money on it? And I've created a platform that I patented last year, and it's a tool that allows filmmakers, once they have content on streaming, is to be able to allow interactivity. And part of that interactivity is allowing people to be able to find items or things in the show that they can purchase. So this, we're seeing a dramatic change in the way consumers watch content. Particularly younger people, but myself included, I can't remember the last time I actually turned on the TV set and watched a show at 8 p.m. on a Thursday night, unless it was a live show like the Oscars or the Super Bowl. So everybody's watching streaming, so where does the advertiser go? How does the content producer make money? And this is a next logical progression of not just product placement, but also advertising itself. Now, being a content producer, I'm conscious of not being too obtuse with everything being so product placement driven that becomes the drive of the content itself. So the interactivity allows the actual user to be able to choose what they engage with, and with that gives the content producer much more power over not just putting a piece of content out there, but also enticing user engagement and potentially leading them somewhere else. Leading them to a product, leading them to their website, leading them to some place where they can actually engage with the filmmaker itself. So that's the stuff that excites me the most, is hopefully allowing, getting content producers another means to generate revenue for their content.
What excites me, my family will all make movies. My wife of 30 years, decide now she wants to be a producer. So she started producing 3 small things, getting paid to do it. And my kids, my 19-year-old kids, you know, just directed a $100,000 music video, Zoo. That was like a week ago, you know. And my other son, he directs. He's an actor, signed with ICM, Louis Tan. He produced, he writes. All my kids write, direct, produce. Even my 17-year-old just went, did a documentary in Tibet with the 5D camera and about the earthquake. So that excites me, that the new generation of filmmakers, cameras are cheaper, the technology allows them to tell their story. And my other son, same thing. You know, he just wrote a script, you know, and now he's looking for funding and, you know, act. They do stunts, you know, they're amazing stunt kids. They do martial art. And so there's a new group of people just one family. All of us are doing something. And we didn't all get together and go, oh, we got to do this. You know, I never actually encouraged them to do into the film industry, you know. But for me, it's not playtime. It's not work. It's playtime for me. I go and play. And so some of you guys are there listening and watching, and they want to play. Well, do what you love. So it's not work, you know. People go, oh, I got to work. I work 18 hours. I go, oh, I'll go play. You know, I go play for 18 hours, and I love it. It's my latest, you know, latest film I'm going to be doing is called LA Gangs, with the producer, you know, verbally has given me a, you know, commitment to Takatuli production, Takatuli, and he wants to do this movie, and then we're gonna spin it into a TV series. So that's, you know, what's up in my life.
Well, thank you all so much. I really appreciate the time and all the great insight. At this point, I'd love to open the floor up to any questions that anyone might have. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Edward Swingler. I'm actually a feature film screenwriter, and actually, as of last year, I got kind of thrown into the directing industry for a new TV series on TV4. And as I was filming and directing the whole thing, I felt like I was on a boat with a hole in it, just filling up and trying to get to shore as fast as I can. So a question I had for all of you guys is, what are the main things you should not do? I want to save time for future projects and stuff like that. What are biggest mistakes as new directors do that, you know, you would advise to avoid to save time later on in production?
Someone else want to go? For me, I think one of the things that you have to make sure to do is that you talk with your talent and make sure that you're on the same page and have a similar vision, so they don't go in thinking something completely different than what you are thinking, and then be willing to listen to what they have to say and compromise and try and get the vision that you want across, but also be willing to work with others and stuff. So.
I agree with that, and also just to remember, you're not making Citizen Kane. That's what a lot of first-time filmmakers, they for some reason, and I'm guilty of this too, I think the first film set I got on where as a director, I thought, I have power, you know? But really, you don't. I mean, really, you're only as powerful as the people that are around you, and if you empower them, they're going to make you better. So if you try to be a dictator and you read all the old books of, how film directors used to yell and scream at people, I think you're going to lead yourself down the wrong path. And I think now more than ever, it's a very, very collaborative medium. So do whatever you can to make sure that you get the most out of the people around you, because they're far more talented than you will ever be by yourself.
I think the key too is to keep it simple. I think for a lot of, all of us at some point, the process can be so overwhelming. There's just so many elements to it. Just figure out what it's about. Like, what is it that you want to say? And just keep that really simple. And then if you can identify that clearly, I think it informs all of the decisions and everything that you make, and everything else becomes a lot easier because you're just following that one guideline and you're going after that one thing that matters the most, whether it's the story, whether it's the performance, what is it that you're trying to say? And I think if you can hone in on that, it'll answer like 98% of the questions or obstacles that you have in front of you.
Yeah, and so save time as well, prep really well, but you can't do like 15, 20 takes, if you're on a low budget movie, So just get what you need, give yourself, 3 to 5 takes, something like that. And be prepared. Don't be the edit. You got to be editing the movie right there and then in your head. You got to be editing already, but prep it really well so that you're not like, oh, I'll edit it, when I get home or in my computer, because you're not done your homework, or I'll just shoot everything and then it will cut together later on. That's not how it works. You gotta really be prepared to tell the story the best possible and the shortest time you got, because you don't have a lot of money and a lot of time. So that's my suggestion to you. Prep really well, tell the story, and then if you got another 20 minutes left because you're so well prepped, now you can put the cherry on top of the pie. I can get this shot. I can get that shot. So always remember, if I'm taking a gun from here, if you don't see me take a gun, I'm not taking a gun. You think I'm taking a gun. You have to see it. So you got to insert shot. It's really important. People miss that. And then they, oh my God, I have to go reshoot it because I didn't get that shot. Or you're not on a location anymore. You're in trouble because you didn't get it. So you need to be prepared to tell the story the best you can and get the shot so that the shot will tell your story. All right? A lot of people make that mistake. And so there's a lot of bad directors out there, right? They not all know what they're doing, I'm just letting you know, all right? So be one of those that are prepared, know what you're doing, right? And if you don't know, don't pretend you know, what I mean? How about directors like, 85% of them, they haven't got a clue what the hell they're doing, and they pretend they know what they're doing, and you don't know, they don't know, but they're not telling you they don't know. If you don't know, just ask them, you've got people, it's a collaboration, so ask your DP, hey man, am I crossing the line here? If you don't know, don't pretend you know, because the person could look that way, and the DP could be saying, hey, no, you got to look that way. listen to what the people are saying. That saves you a lot of money and a lot of time. And, you know, they are your team. So work with them, you know? And
if I would say, just be ready to adapt to any situation. It goes along with the prepping thing because nothing ever goes as you plan. So you plan it as much as you can in your head, but then just prepared like, oh, someone didn't show up or the car breaks down. But if you know what you want so well, you'll know how to cut things out and say, okay, well, we don't need that, or we could cover and get the same point across by adapting. I think it's just that preparation helps you adapt during the day, but just be prepared that nothing's ever going to go on schedule, or you know things are going to happen that there's going to be roadblocks in the way.
I mean, even from the simplest things like coffee doesn't show up in the morning, like something simple like that can ruin the first 3 hours of the day. I've had it happen to me on my set. Like the caterer didn't show up on time, and I've got a whole bunch of people that are hungry, angry, and half asleep.
I think Spielberg said it best. I think someone asked him, like, what's the key to filmmaking? And he said, knowing where to park the trucks. This is true. You don't have trucks, you don't have equipment, you don't have anything. So it really comes down to, I mean, we philosophize, in all the film books about learning how to do the lighting and how to, do the craft. But if you don't plan out the logistics, you've got nothing.
I liked what I think Kubrick said. I think he might have said it to Spielberg, but it was a DGA thing where he said the most impressive thing that directors do is get out of the car in the morning, because I've had that feeling where you have all this anxiety and you see all these people setting up and you're like, okay, but then once you're in it, it's a lot of fun and it's a rush.
Yes, young lady in the back.
Hey guys, how's it going? My name's Ian too. So hey, Ian, it's really weird. My question actually is for Kevin. So I've started directing a bunch of music videos, and I'm doing like a documentary, and I do mostly narrative stuff, but I want to venture also into commercials. So I just read in your bio that you directed a bunch of commercials as well. I was just wondering how you made that transition and how would I go about doing that?
It's not a simple. Commercials are their own sort of art form. And as simple as 30 seconds of something on screen might appear, the amount of stuff, and because it's directing by committee, it really is, and you're being sold a concept that someone else has come up with. But to answer your question in the most simple way, I went out and shot a spec reel. And I think anyone that's getting into commercials, the majority of them, you have to have at the minimum three really good spec spots, or you need to have a body of work that speaks to being concise like that. Other work is hard to translate specifically unless a client sees one of your films or something that you currently have and says, that's our commercial, and then you will have the opportunity to bid on that. And then I'll tell you that process in itself is very different than getting anything that you've made already, because it's more about making sure that all the clients and the agencies and the laundry list of people who are actually gonna sign off on writing that big check to let you go direct, they all have to have a very clear idea as to what you're going to do. I mean, even down to like the color of the props, and you've got to create. It becomes a very kind of different thing than narrative filmmaking, where you're really servicing a story, a concept. You're really servicing that. With commercials, and Warren can speak to this too. It's about servicing a brand. And so that has all kinds of different implications. Yes, you're trying to wrap it in a really cool story that people are going to watch and that's compelling, but you have to be able to show the product the right way, hit the feature sets that they want, and then make sure that your casting looks like the customer that they want or that they have, even if that's not the best actor that walked through the room in auditions. And so in order to do that, typically, you have to have examples of commercials that are really good.
If you want to do a car commercial, if you want to be a car commercial director, then you should shoot a car spec or something that shows that. Because they have their jobs on the line, so they want to find the director that they'll have something that's as close to what they're looking for, I think.
They majority of the work that commercial directors book is because the commercial that they're getting is very similar to one that they already have on their reel. It sounds ludicrous, but the commercial world is very, very different in that regard. But to get started, I would say you need to shoot a minimum of 3 really good specs, or have like 1 or 2 that also speak to what the rest of your body of work does, and then get some really good reps who know the good agencies and the people that your work will resonate with. Because that's really, to get a start, that's really what you need to do is the creative directors and the people who are making the creative decisions at the advertising agencies, if they're really enthused about your work, then they'll make it work for their spot. So it's a lot of times it's about getting the right people that believe in what you do, that can connect you to those folks.
Also, it wouldn't hurt to look at commercial pitches too, the actual kind of treatments that people make, just to see how directors sort of
pitch their ideas.
Yeah, articulate everything in words. That's the toughest thing for me is the pitch process too. Is
treatments are mind bending.
It's because you're trying to describe a visual thing or a feeling in words and pictures, and you know you haven't shot it yet, so you got to find Google Images and that hint at it, but you don't want to hint at something in the wrong way. So the images are very important, and the kinds of ways that you're talking about the brand are very important.
How many different ways you can say premium?
Yeah. Elevated, premium, pristine. Yeah.
My son shot a spec, again, Levi's commercial, you know, and he used the Levi's to beat the crap out of like several guys, you know, and he started it and he gets the girl at the end, you know, and that commercial, him and his buddy shot it. And his buddy went on to do two years in Asia as a commercial director. And he didn't want to go because he wanted to concentrate on his acting here. So he stayed, you know, and he's going up for some very, very big movie, Louis Tan. But that's how you do it. You did a spec, actually showed it to Levi. Levi goes, why didn't we think of that? That was so good. How is it that we can't do that? And we pay all our guys all this money. You know, this is not right, you know? And they didn't buy it off us, but they allowed us to show it, you know, to see. So, and they actually put it in one of their sites just to show the brand, you know? But it's something like that. I mean, Joseph Kahn was very good. I used to work for him on doing all the music video. And he transitioned from music video to commercial, you know, gracefully, you know, but he did a lot of music video. You know, we did a lot of stuff like the Missy Elliott Get Your Free Call music video. Did a lot of the action for them and the Wu-Tang Clan and Cisco and, you know, Shakira. You know, we won like 5 MTV awards. But I did all the action for these directors, you know. So anyway, it's something for you to think about.
There's a website called SpecBank, which is S-P-E-C, SpecBank.com. And it's it costs something stupidly cheap, like $5 for however long you want to join. But it has a bank of spec scripts that agency copywriters, that's where they put their, what they call their dead scripts. They've written a bunch of concepts that haven't gotten sold through, but they want to see them made. So they put them in this spec bank. And you can go in and you pay your $5 and you can read through whatever you want to do. And then you contact the copywriter and say, hey, I found your spec. Would you let me shoot it? And they'll say yes or no. And then once you get the green light, you go and shoot it. And that's my suggestion, actually, because you'll make a relationship with someone at an agency. And if they like the way you shot it, they'll log that away. And then the other thing too is you'll start to learn that collaboration, because it's very different than going off and making your own film. Hmm. Any other questions? Sir.
Hi, my name is Brandon Shim, and this question is for Ian. I was very interested when you talked about the interactivity platform. Is that a proprietary software, or is that a package software, and how effective did you find it in using the interactive platform in terms of promoting the work?
It's proprietary. It's actually in prototype mode right now, and we're going to be launching it in the next few, probably couple months. After I go to London to premiere my film, I'm actually going to New York to meet my investors. And we're still in the development phase of it, but it's a web app. It's something that actually is designed to be agnostic, that anything that's streaming through any video streaming platform should be able to apply this to the content and allow interactivity through the content. It's pretty simple. I mean, it's not, I think the best technology is something that creates convenience. And the iPhone is a perfect example of it. iPhone didn't invent the phone. They didn't invent the calculator, the GPS, or the email, or the messaging, or anything like that. They just took it and put it into a common platform. So what I'm attempting to do with this platform is allow a system that allows content makers, when they put content up there, to add interactive components to it. So that way it can route the user to another source, be it a retailer and or their own personal website and or, you know, some other link.
Steven.
Hi, thanks. First of all, great panel. I really enjoyed it. My name is Steven J. Kung, and I read recently that the producers of the show, of the movie Ghost in a Shell, used visual effects to make Scarlett Johansson to make her look more Asian. I was wondering if this sort of like virtual whitewashing is a thing, if it's commonplace, and if any of you have had any experience with it.
I certainly haven't had any experience in it being whitewashing. It is not a specific technology, I think, that they're using, but there's this thing almost any film, television show, commercial does it's called cleanup. And it allows to help clean up imperfections in makeup or facial stuff. It's the same thing as Photoshop, basically. You can, because of the quality of technology, you can key on any kind of geometry within a frame. And clearly described, because I've read those articles too, is they've used it to help change the shape of her face and in a subtle way.
Why not just cast an Asian actor?
Hello, thank you. I think it's disgusting.
That's my vote.
I think that what they're doing, if you're listening, you're a producer, you better listen very carefully, because that is just wrong. Just cast an Asian for that role, all right?
And Asia's, you know, the biggest market, too. That's the kind of puzzling thing, is the biggest sales now occur. And my film, too, has one European territory sold, and all the other ones are Asia. So it is a little bit puzzling. Hopefully we collectively in the room can kind of lead the charge on that, because I think we Asians tend to be a little bit more passive sometimes when it comes to being, you know, outspoken about our civil rights and our presence, particularly in media. And hopefully we can enact some change to make it clear that people will go see it, because it's a genre piece. And people didn't go see the Avengers because of any particular actor. They saw it because of the Avengers. And mm-hmm. Who were these people who were Spider-Man before they cast them as Spider-Man? I mean, I would say that Spider-Man made Tobey Maguire more than Tobey Maguire made Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. So I think that's hopefully we can collectively have some voice and action in that. But to your point, there are many tools. I don't know if there's the Asian app that you can press, but... on my film, definitely, there's a lot of filters and tools that you can use to clean up people's faces. It's a beauty button. You know, I just call it the Coolify button. Every time there's someone who looked like, you know, they stayed up too late last night and they had bags under their eyes, you just Coolify them and they look beautiful.
Yeah. All this stuff has got to stop. You know, I've been in the business now 35 years, and you know, it's a disgrace the way we've been treated in Hollywood and around the world. Now, that stuff's gonna have to stop now. You know, we gotta have to say something. Yes, we're passive. Yes, we're passive aggressive people. But you know what? When we like something, we put our money where our mouth is. We go see and support whatever we like. Now we, as a group of people, you know, we go to see movies a lot because we work hard and we got money, you know, and we go support, you know, this movie or that movie. So they better be catering, because China's come around the corner. That's our forefather over there, you know, and they got a lot of money.
And they're sick and tired of this stuff, by the way. I just want to let you know, because I talked to them 7 years ago when they came. We want to collaborate with Hollywood, not to be put under another regime and you tell us what to do. We got the money. We want to collaborate with you. This is not collaboration. This is like axing out a group of people. You know, some call it racism. So you better check yourself and, you know, look at your own heart on what is going on here. This is a movie that is that a lot of people feel very passionate about. You know, and to do what you're doing is wrong, simply wrong. You know, correct this mistake. Don't keep doing this stuff. You know, the African-American community, they did that. There'll be an uproar. There'll be rioting. You know, they won't riot, you know, in the street, but they'll riot and go, we're going to boycott this movie, and we're going to say our voice is going to be heard. Stop it. Imagine that. Imagine, you know, it's the other way around. It's a black character, and they put a white guy in there. Can you imagine that?
Yeah, I think it starts at the root level too, because I think that there's only so much the Academy can do, because the Academy has an African American female that runs it, but she can't make the films, you know, any more than the DGA can hire the directors. The DGA doesn't hire directors. The DGA only takes people that qualify to be in the DGA because they get hired by a studio. So I think that the awareness seems amongst the Asian American committee too. This is a topic that we talk about quite a bit, and I'm sure it carries over into all the other diversity groups. But I hope that you know, this collective reasoning starts to infiltrate into the people who actually are in the positions to hire. Because there's only so much you can browbeat the Academy Awards if they're just not generating movies that have African American or Asian American or any of that type of cast. If the studios that are still getting green light, and or they allow someone to make a movie in Hawaii that everybody's white, including the Asian characters, I mean, this is happening at the studio level, and hopefully the awareness is happening. But also, I do think that you know, on social media or whatever means you have, just be active as much as you can to create that awareness.
Not to diminish the topic, but to bring us back on point. Are there any other questions?
Actually, we need to. I'm sorry. We need to
wrap
cut
it up.
Short
sorry.
Right now.
Sorry, Milton. I apologize.
No, that's okay. But everyone, please, let's give this panel a big round of applause.